All right. So today I want to talk about how to deal with discouragement. 2 Kings chapter 4 in verse 18. 2 Kings chapter 4 in verse 18. This is the story of a woman that received a miracle. She had had no child. Eventually, she met the prophet Elisha. And when she met Prophet Elisha, and it was a very challenging way you met Prophet Elisha. Prophet Elisha, I'm so blessed. You know, just thinking, you know, normally in the fourth service, there's a leader that normally sits at the back there. And she's about 10 years into marriage, but has no child. And, you know, she just gave birth sometime last month, you know. Yeah. And she was giving me a wine press testimony and all of those kind of things. Her husband was like, Pastor, you can't believe this, you know. And just, you know, I mean, two pregnant people. I met one earlier, and so they with their bomb, and one said, I'm 5 years without a child. This is my wine press baby. And they were just telling me, just, you know, just the faithfulness and the goodness of God. And that testimony should encourage you no matter where you are. So maybe you're believing for a baby. Don't say, God, when. Say, God, thank you, because I know your power is real, and I know they are doing it for others, and mine also included in it. So that's the way to think about it. Because sometimes, if you don't process testimony very well, you can get discouraged. Yes or no? Exactly. Okay, so let's go now. So this woman didn't have a child. Eventually, she did something very supernatural for the prophet. She did something very supernatural for the prophet. What did she do for the prophet? What she did was that she built the prophet a place to stay. And Elisha ministered to her. And she had the child, got pregnant, delivered the child. So the child was grown. So this is where the child was grown. So the Bible says in verse 18, and the child was grown, and it fell on the day that when he went out to his father's, to the reapers. Let's continue. The Bible says in verse 19, and he said to his fathers, my head, and he said unto a lad, carry him to his mother. Verse 20, and when he was taken, and when he had taken him, he brought him to his mother, and he sat on her knees till noon, and he died. Now imagine, they've been trying to have this child for such a long time. They eventually had the child. The child is maybe about 10 years old, and the child died on her. This is a terrible place to be. Verse 21, the Bible says, and she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God, and shut the door upon him, and went out. The Bible says in verse 22, and she called unto her husband and said, send me, I pray thee, one of the young men, and one of the asses, one of the donkeys, that I may run to the man of God and come again. Verse 23, the Bible says this, and he said to her, wherefore wilt thou go to the man of God? It's neither the new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well. So the husband was saying that, hey, why are you looking for the man of God? She even refused to tell the husband that the child is dead. What he told the husband was like, hey, just send me a vehicle to take me to the man of God. The husband said, why are you going to see the man of God? He said, because it shall be well. The Bible says this. Look at what the Bible says. The Bible says this. Then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, drive, go fast, slack not for riding for me, except I bid thee. He said that, drive as fast as you can. You know, you could imagine this woman, and let me say something to you. It's one thing to pray for something and never have it. It's one thing when you pray for something that you've had it and you seem to lose it. It's another level of heartbreak. If you've never enjoyed something before, you will never know what it means to be without it. So this woman was in a very bad place. And the reason I'm saying so is that a lot of us are in a season where you're very discouraged. Maybe you're discouraged about, why do people get discouraged? Where you're discouraged about you doing the right thing and you're not experiencing the results that you want. You're discouraged because there's something you've been waiting for a long time and that's not happened. You're discouraged because someone that should do you good eventually turns back and do you bad. There's a lot of reasons to be discouraged. But for this woman, the reason why she was discouraged was very powerful. She was discouraged, you know, she was in a state that could discourage her. And in that state was because she had a testimony that was growing bad. The Bible says in verse 24, she saddled, verse 25 now, 25. Where do you want to stay? Okay, 25. So the Bible says she went and came to the man of God, to the Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her afar off, he said unto Gehazi, his servant, Behold, yonder is a Shunammite woman. Verse 26. And the Bible says this, run now, I pray thee, to meet her, and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with thy child? And she answered and said, it is well. You know, one of the things that amazed me is this. How does someone go through so much negativity and remains positive? I mean, she's lost a daughter. The husband asks you, is it well? You said it's well. The servant of the man of God asks you, is it well? You said it is well. So the question is that, what are the common things that causes discouragement amongst people? I will say one, and I will give three people opportunity to tell me what are the common things that cause discouragement. The first thing that causes discouragement is this. Number one, when you're doing the right thing and you're not getting the results that you expect. How many of you have been through that before? Yeah. You know, you hear things like, but I'm doing everything right. Why are things not working out? And you become so discouraged because it's almost as if it's not worth it doing the right thing. I've been there before. You know, there was a time in our church that I wanted to see some changes, and I did everything I knew to do, and it wasn't just showing up. And I was like, Lord, I've done everything. What's going wrong? Okay, that's one. So give me another reason why people get discouraged, or why you get discouraged. Where's the microphone? Are the microphones working today? Yeah. What? Yeah. You need to be on the two edge so we cannot be listening. Give another reasons why people get discouraged, why you got discouraged. Yeah. Just hands up. You know, I'm sure everybody has gotten discouraged. There's a lady over there. Yeah. There's a lady over there. You need to go to the people I point you to. Lady over there. Yeah. And Calibi, you need to avoid the camera front view. Yeah. If you're not, all right. Yeah, so what are some other things that causes discouragement? That's it. So tell me, what are some other things that causes discouragement? Yeah.
When you're praying and you don't seem to see the answer.
Well, when you're praying and you don't see, how do you feel when that happens to you?
Sometimes I feel like maybe God doesn't answer prayers.
Yeah, you feel as if God doesn't answer prayer. Okay, thank you. So someone else that wants to say something, what are some things that discourage you currently or has been like that in your life? Yeah? Yeah. Another person. There's a brother. Okay, there's someone over there. Then we'll come to the brother in front. Tell me. You can have your seats, please.
Example. Something happened in my workplace two months ago.
Just remember, you have 1 minute.
Okay, actually doing a promotion stuff. So
my sister,
I was qualified. It's
okay. Just remember, you have 1 minute.
Okay, yeah. When you pray and you don't see instant results,
yeah.
And you've put more effort,
yeah.
Thinking that the results will come, it did not. I got discouraged. But let's say later, one or two people talked to me. Pastor Dan for me, Avestas Baga that spoke with me, and others said, then I picked up again. So I think that's the main reason why people get discouraged.
Okay, when you, it's either when you pray or do something right, and okay,
no
thank
results.
You. Yes, there's a guy at your back. Yeah, there's a guy at your back. Yeah.
I think one of the reasons is when you put too much effort in certain things, expecting many results, and the result is not actually coming the way you expect.
Wow. Wow. Excellent. There's someone at your back also. Yeah.
Mine is you are praying for sexy things. Some are happening, and then there's just this particular one that just seems to happen. No matter how you pray about it.
So the major thing is that you're doing something and you're expecting another kind of result and you can get discouraged. That's great. We seem to all be human. Praise the Lord. Yeah, because it seems someone else, I want to say something. There's a brother in front here. Yeah. Yeah. There's a brother in front here. Some of you are raising your hand like this. I don't know what that means. There's a brother in, yeah. Here. Exactly. There's a brother in front here. Yeah. Why did you get this card? Yeah. Is it on? Please always turn it on before you give it to them. Yeah. Yeah. Can you move and help us with the microphone? Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I think one of the things that had really gotten me so discouraged is praying, and then the Lord said, this is what he's going to do.
Yeah.
And then you're waiting for it and walking towards it, and it seems like nothing. There's
it's
no
not going
sign
on.
At
okay,
all.
Okay, that's fine. Pass the microphone to the lady at the back.
Okay,
Okay, one thing is you're praying, you're doing everything, but the person closer to you is really doing nothing, like totally, absolutely nothing, but then they are getting everything. For you that have prayed, you are getting totally nothing. So that causes discouragement as well.
So you are the one praying, skabashing. This person doesn't pray or skabash, and is almost rolling into all the testimonies. I hope you know that's in the Bible. That happens on the Bible. You know that, right? Have you seen that in the Bible before? Let me show you. Psalm 73. Oh, wow. Psalm 73. Verse 2. Let's read together. Let's read. I want to go. As for me, my sleeps were almost finished, were almost gone, and my steps are near. We have a problem. Okay. It says, for me, my feet were almost gone and my steps were nearly slipped. Verse 3. It says, when I was what? Of the prosperity of the wicked. Verse 4. It says, for there is no band in their debt. Their strength is firm. Verse 5. They are not in trouble like other men. Neither are they plagued like what? Other men. Can you please fix this? Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. They are not in trouble as other men, neither are they pricked like other men. Verse 6. Therefore, pride compassed them like by a chain, violence compassed them as a garment. Verse 7. Their eyes stand now with fatness. They have more than their heart could wish for. Does that remind you of yourself? Oh, verse 8. They are corrupt. They speak wickedly against oppression. They speak loftily. Verse 9. They set their mouth against the heavens and their tongue walks through the earth. You know, and verse 10. Therefore, these people return hither, water of the full cup, and are run out to them. Verse 11. And they say, what doeth God? Is there knowledge in the Most High? Yeah, go ahead. Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verse 12. Verily, is that how you feel? Yeah. Verily, have I cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. Wow. I love the fact that, you know what I love about the Bible? The fact that where you are, sun has been there. I love that. I love that where you are, sun has been there. So, because a lot of you, you know, the first time I read this chapter, I was like, this chapter, this person seems like me. So, all of you are right. These are the different things that cause discouragement. Number one, you're doing the right thing and it's not happening for you just the way you thought about it. You're praying that it's not happening. You're working hard and the progress is not doing well. And also, discouragement can come when you lose something. So the question is this. Discouragement, will it happen once in a while or it will happen over life? It will happen over life. So if discouragement will happen over life, what I want to say is that, what is your plan to stand back on your feet when you feel discouraged? That's the plan. What is your plan? So if you felt this way before, there'll be times in your life. Let me tell you something. If you're a strong Christian, there are going to be times in your life you are going to wonder, God, are you blind? Can't you hear me? Can I be honest with you? If you have been a Christian for some time, you would have gotten to the point where you feel like, Father, what is going on here? Ah, is it that you choose to see or you choose to be blind? Is it that you choose not to answer me? But you know what I want to say to you? Strong faith is built in difficult times. I'm telling you, strong faith is built in difficult times. Until your child is dead, you can't know God can resurrect. And the thing is this, it's when you go through difficult time, you can look back and be like, wow, God came through for me. In fact, when people are going through challenges, the only reason why I can encourage them is because I've seen God come through in very tough situation. And with that strength, I'm able to encourage them. So let's go to why you want to deal with discouragement. Number one, if you don't deal with discouragement, the first thing that will happen to you is that you'll begin to self-sabotage. What's self-sabotage? You'll begin to do things that would cancel what you are praying for. You'll begin to do things. Who knows what I'm talking about? You begin to do things that will cancel. Who can give an example? You're praying for something. Let me give an example. You'll see a couple praying to have a baby, and the baby has not come, and you see that the womb starts sleeping each other, as if the baby will jump on them. And that's what discouragement does. You get to a place where you begin to self-sabotage. You begin to work against your own miracle. Okay, someone wants to share a story with us. What's the story to share? Yeah, how you began to self-sabotage because things, you got discouraged. Anybody? Yeah. No, I don't want to have shared before. I'll tell you what to share. Yeah. How you begin to self-sabotage. Any other person that I've not shared before? Yeah. That person has not shared. Yeah. Yeah, tell me.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Okay.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I could remember when I was in university. So every semester I do set goal of 5.0. And at the end of the
Everybody
day,
tried that at one point. Yeah.
So
no, come on. Did everybody try that at one point or the other? I did in year one. I said five. Everybody was like, GP 5.0. You know, everybody said that. Then in about year two or year three, you just got wiser, right? Then everyone in the university finished the first class. Then so along the year 2-1, they're like 2-2, no bad there. Continue, please. Yeah.
So at the end of the semester, I would say 3.7, 3.5, 3. God, why? And I had some friends that they can sleep like a dead man, and they will still end up having 4.7, this and that. I was like, well, maybe this thing is not meant for me. So I stopped reading the way I used to read.
And when you stop, things don't go better, right?
Not really.
What happened? Your GP what?
So my GP came from 4.0 to 3.7. I was like, guy, you need to go back to aiming high.
Which is what I'm saying to you. When you eventually become discouraged and you stop doing the right thing, things don't get better, they only get worse. This is why you need to encourage yourself. The reason why is that if you choose, please, can you help me fix this glitch on the sound? Peter, can you help me fix this glitch on the sound? What is the problem? What? What's the problem? Thanks. Because there's a glitch, you know. So the thing is this, when you become discouraged and you stop doing the right things, when you stop doing the right things, things don't get better because you stop doing the right things. As a matter of fact, things get worse. And that's why I'm teaching this. The reason why I'm teaching this is that a lot of you, things will get better if you just keep being consistent. And a lot of you here, you stop doing the right thing. So let me use relationship for example. You stop putting out yourself there because you're too discouraged from relationship. Some of you have stopped trying when it comes to business. You've just stopped trying. Who else is trying? But the thing is that when you stop trying, things don't get better because you stop trying. I'll give an example. Maybe you are using your faith for a miracle and you need to confess the word of God morning and evening, and you got discouraged because you confessed for 3 months and nothing has happened. What do you do? I understand you are human. You can feel tired. But when you come back to yourself, the Bible says, and David encouraged himself in the Lord. You get back on your faith and you keep confessing. The reason why is that things are not going to get better by you doing nothing. You must remember that. Things are not going to get better by you doing nothing. And the first thing encouragement will do to you is this. You will start self-sabotaging the things you should do. So some of you are here. Maybe there's a medical procedure you're going through and there are drugs you have to take and you're not getting tired. But getting tired will not change your health. Maybe you're meant to work on a business deal and you have worked for the past 2 months and there's nothing working. But stopping that will not change anything. I understand that you've been through many relationships and it doesn't work. But getting tired right now will not work. The reason why is that you need to be consistent. The Bible says, this is what the Bible says. It says, he that observe the wind will not sow. Meaning that what? If you're looking at how you feel, you'll never do what is right. And like that brother shared, when it got discouraged, things got worse. They didn't get better. This is what I always tell myself. If with prayer, is this challenging? If I don't pray, how will it be? So I don't think that my prayer is a minus. I think my prayer is a plus. If with prayer things are this challenging, if I don't pray, how will it be? So this helps me to put a lot of my attention on my prayers. Glory to God. I say glory to God. I say glory to God. Why don't you want to be discouraged? The second reason I don't discourage is this: when you become discouraged, then you all of a sudden become negative. Have you noticed that also? When you become discouraged, you don't just become negative, you see everything from a perspective of negativity. Okay, who wants to tell me what that means to you? Yeah, yes, my sister in white, lady in white, yeah, on your right.
It was not going well at all, and I kind of put myself in a bubble, and man, it was horrible.
And what about you put yourself in a bubble?
So I'm a chef, and okay. I put myself in a very specific, okay, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, not really diversifying. And so I gave up any business idea or any if anybody comes to me with advice, I'm like, no, it won't work. And I've not even tried it yet.
And you just became negative.
Yes. So there was nothing that was positive. Even the business, it just became a negative thing for me.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So how did you come out of it? Are you still there right now? You've come out of it.
No, I've definitely come out.
How did you come out of it?
Thankfully, my former boss, he got me a job. And this one, I even got the job without any interview or anything. It was just based on, you did a good job when you worked for me, you should work here. And so that really established my self-esteem and confidence.
That's great. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So who else, when you were going through things, you became very discouraged, you know, became negative. You became very negative. The lady in black, yeah? Yeah, lady in black, yeah? The microphone is coming to you. You've passed her.
When I was trying to get another job,
okay,
and I kept studying, writing assessments, and nothing.
Okay.
At some point, I got discouraged, and I was like, I'm not going to get another job, so there's no point trying. I stopped speaking of 3 a.m., because what was the point of waking up 3 a.m. when you're still going to fail, right? So I just stopped, and also I stopped putting myself out there, meeting new people, because I'm like...
So number one, you stop preparing?
Yes.
Then number two, you stop increasing your network?
Just stop.
So what changed?
Well, I realized I was getting more depressed and I was getting sad.
This is the thing. This one, normal depression. Because once you stop, depression makes you feel as if it's not working. But once you stop doing what you need to do, it gets worse. So it feels as if your prayer is not working. It feels as if your hard work is not working. So once you stop, what happened? It doesn't get better because you stop. It only gets worse because you stop. So the reason why you have to keep going is this. You need to remind yourself, my stopping doesn't make it better. It only makes it worse. So, you began to slide downwards, right?
Yes, I did.
How bad was that for you?
It was so bad that I stopped looking at myself in the mirror, because everything, even at my former workplace, I worked so hard on various projects, and I just lost that confidence that, I'm not good, I'm not the best project manager I wanted to be.
And you know, the negativity moves from one thing and moves to your person. That's what I'm going to. You don't only feel negative about you, about something, you become the negative. You begin to think there's something wrong with you. And the reason I'm saying so is that a lot of us are here and you're terribly discouraged. And there are couples that will start fighting each other instead of fighting the problem. There are couples that when there's a problem in their marriage, instead of fighting the problem, they will begin to fight each other and make each other like the problem itself. But you need to ask yourself, the reason why I can't choose to be discouraged is this. If I choose to be discouraged, this is not going to change. The only way this can change is that I'm going to keep fighting. You must remember that. I'm going to keep fighting. Can I be deep today? Can I be deep today? How many of you are fighting pornography? Yeah. How many of you are fighting chemicals? And you get discouraged because The harder you say, I will not do it, the more you plunge into it. So you don't look at the pornographic video for 1 week. You say, ah, I'm a victor in Jesus' name. Ah, 1 week, I didn't look at it. The next week, it was morning, afternoon, and night. Almost as if you were covering up for what you were doing before. But the thing is this, you don't have to throw in the tower. You just have to push. Have to push through it. Because not doing anything in the sea of discouragement, it's going to make it worse. It's going to what? Make it worse. Same thing when it comes to relationship. I know that you dated 3 people that were not great people, but that's not the end of your life. How do you deal with discouragement? Number one way is this. You must, if you stay discouraged, you'll quit, then you become what? Negative. Those two things are not good for you. You want to say something, the lady with the hair? Yeah, say, tell me what's in your mind. Yeah, tell me, give her the microphone. And I'm going to ask her to give her the microphone, pass it to her. Yeah. Yeah, give me the microphone. Tell me what's happening. I can hear you. Just hold it closer to your mouth.
She's been the only one doing everything for us. So she actually asked me to apply. And I did. We did everything. She gave me a Canadian account. And I put in everything. I was so, so positive that it was going to come. Because I've actually given up. Like, there's nothing interesting here anymore. And the rejection came, and I took it. I said, okay, I'll keep praying. But as it seems now, it's more like the
prayer. Can you hold the microphone closer, little?
It's not working. I'm discouraged. Every night I dream of rejection, visa ban. I don't even know. I'm scared. I'm an orphan, and I have people looking out for me. The rejection, it seems like, okay, there's something wrong with me, because I've seen people that I know that are getting it.
And they're not even qualified like you.
They don't even have people helping them like me. My sister has a big account to do it. So what is holding it?
So the question is this. Yeah. And the reason why is that she's sharing her story, but this way a lot of us are. Because she's wondering that what is holding me. You, it's travel. Some people it's marriage. Some people it's pregnancy. Some people it's a job. And this is the first thing you need to know is that there's nothing that happens to you that is not common to man. Don't make your problem personal. Yes. You don't want to say to you, the first thing is that you are thinking of your problem in terms of your personal thing. You have a problem. You are not the problem. Say, I'm not the problem. Yeah, that's the first thing. Because the thing about discouragement is that discouragement will start making you feel that you are the problem. Do you feel that way sometimes?
Every time.
So, tell me, yeah? Yeah. Tell me in the microphone, yeah. Do you feel that way sometimes?
Every time.
You feel you're the problem?
Every day, every second as I'm sitting here, I still feel I'm the problem. I just feel there's something wrong. I feel I'm not good enough. I feel God... I don't deserve God's grace or whatever. Like, that's how I feel.
You don't feel that way. So I want to ask you a question. If you keep feeling this way, how will you go forward?
I'm stuck.
That's it?
I'm stuck.
Yeah, that's it. So the question is that, what is going to change for you to go forward?
I don't know. The only thing that is going to change is for me to just wake up one morning and...
It's to wake up one morning and do what?
And I'm out of this place.
And what? What did she say? What?
And I'm out of this place.
What? What's your name?
Stella.
Stella, I want to really help you now. True change does not start from the outside. True change starts on the inside. So the first thing that must change is that you must change how you are thinking. Did you see what you did? You did?
Because?
Yeah.
To some extent, yeah. I think I'm an overthinker. I think of the worst case scenario.
Yeah.
They will just ban me. They will just deny me. I will now look for another country and go to. Or,
so I want to ask you. So this negative thinking, how has it helped you?
It hasn't done anything.
Exactly. So why don't you want to change it?
Because I don't know how to change it.
So if you don't, why not ask how to change it?
I've asked.
What did you ask?
She.
Has she changed her own mind?
Yes, she has.
The reason why is that sometimes you keep asking people that have not helped themselves. I'm not saying your friend has not helped herself, but I'm just saying sometimes. Because some of you here, when you have medical problems, you ask someone that's not a doctor. Can the person heal himself?
No.
Shoot himself. Let me tell you how to change your thinking. Stand up. This last week, think of three great things that have happened in your life. What are the three things you're thankful for? This week or this year? Three things.
This year. My elder brother, who has been out of job, finally got a job after like 5 years.
But I thought God hated your family.
He loves us. He loves us. And
what are you grateful for?
I'm grateful for the fact that I got a job, a better job.
Oh, but God hates you. But he also gave you a better job, right?
And I'm also grateful he gave me someone good. He gave me a good person.
Oh, you're dating someone. But just 2 or 3 minutes ago, you were crying. God doesn't like
I'm
me.
Still
God
crying. Is I'm still crying. I'm still crying. And the problem now is that the person is not here. The person is over there.
Hold on. Let me tell you what the Lord has done for you. Number one, you even have a sister that is inviting you abroad. All the people here are looking for someone to invite them abroad. Let me tell you something. When you are discouraged, you discount what is in your hands and prefer what someone else's hands. Do you see how they say, let someone invite me, oh, let someone invite. People, they even know that is abroad, they don't have fat account or paper to invite them. You have a sister that has legal papers that can sponsor your trip to invite you. You need to slow down and say, Lord, you've done so much already. Then someone even give you another man. You don't understand. People in the country where your man is are praying that he will see them. No, I'm not saying that he will see them. They are praying he will see them. He left all of them in that. What country is he in?
Canada.
He's in Canada. Do you know how many Africans and Nigerians and single white people are in Canada praying that your boyfriend, just for example, his name is Victor, will say, Victor, see me. Victor doesn't see any of them. God covers his eyes, directs his eyes towards you in Nigeria. And you're doing love by telephone. And the guy has still stayed. Is that not the grace of God? You know, let me tell you something. Watch this now. How many of you feel she's ungrateful? Raise up your hands. Look. Put out your hands. Let me tell you something. I don't think you're ungrateful. I'll tell you what you are. I think you're focused on the things that are not going right, and that has made you ungrateful and discouraged. And guess what? The moment you're ungrateful, even what you have, you will lose it. Because you're saying God has done nothing. God said, okay, since I've done nothing, in Jamaica, leave them alone. Lift up your two hands like this. Put the microphone close to your mouth. Say, Lord, I'm grateful.
Lord, I'm grateful.
You love me.
You love me.
You care about me.
You care about me.
You gave me a sister.
That cares about me.
Willing to sponsor my relocation.
Ready to sponsor my relocation.
You gave me a man.
That loves me.
You gave my brother a job. You're kind to me. How do you feel right now?
Okay. So I feel relieved. Not like.
if you're relieved.
Yes.
But what you need to do for yourself is this. This alone will not change you. You need to always go back to the place where you can remind yourself about the things the Lord has done for you. Remember, whatever is in your life will multiply. So if you dwell on the thought of positivity, it will multiply. If you dwell on negativity, it will multiply. What are you dwelling on now? So just some minutes ago, you were crying. But look at you today, now you're laughing. And the reason why was that I just made you make a decision to dwell on thoughts that are positive. God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Is there another person that is discouraged? Someone that is discouraged? Very discouraged. I don't want someone that is mad and very discouraged. Some of you have even finished suicidal. You want to kill yourself. You know, yeah, some people like that. Suicidal. Anybody like that? You know, suicidal. No, suicidal first. You're very, raise your hands above your head. I want to see. You feel maybe someone just convinced you to come. Or maybe your friend, the guy in black. Yeah, you feel suicidal sometimes? No, if you don't feel suicidal, we're not raising up your hands, you know. Do you feel suicidal sometimes? Yes or no? Just yes or no? Yeah, okay. Give me the microphone. Praise God. Remember the story we read? This woman, a child was... So let me teach you the first principle here. Ever look. This is the first principle. Remember a child that died. And when a child died, what did she say? She kept saying, it is well. It is well. One of the key ways to get out of discouragement is to start saying what you want, not what you feel. One of the ways to get out of discouragement is to say what you want, not what you feel. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so... I just moved from a label I was working with before.
Are you an artist? Or what do you do?
I do marketing and communications for brands. So I was working with this label before, and then, you know, putting in so much effort, growing, like, develop the artist and a lot of things. And then someone who, you know, I literally trained through the process of the label.
Someone that you what?
I literally trained through the process of, like, you know, working with a label and adding value, just suddenly started, you know, telling the label that I'm not capable of what I was doing.
Can you hold the microphone closer to you so I can hear you?
Yeah. So you just started telling the label that I'm no longer capable of what I was doing anymore.
So yeah. How did that make you feel?
It made me feel like, you know, I've put in so much, and, you know, I just felt so secluded, and after everything I've done, you know, you just come and see.
So how did that make you feel?
It made me feel so, like, that was the end of the world, and, you know, like...
What about it was the end of the world?
I was like, I don't think I can give people so much, and, you know, I don't think...
So
I
you felt just, used?
I felt used, very used.
When you told your friends about how you felt, what did you tell your friends how you felt?
I told my friends that I don't think I'll be going to this extent for anyone, and it also made me feel... incapable, like I do everything.
You felt useless, you felt incapable.
Because this person actually reached out to someone I trained to come and lead the role I was taking on. So it made me feel very, you know, useless, and, like, you know, I couldn't do what I was doing anymore, and I couldn't think straight, I couldn't think of strategies, I just felt everything was wrong. So
that's where you are right now.
No, like it still makes me feel sad, but I'm healed to a reasonable extent. Right now, because at the end of the day,
don't worry about how you're healed. I understand that. So how do you feel right now? So sometimes you feel incompetent.
Yes, sometimes.
Sometimes you feel redundant.
Yes, sometimes I feel that way.
So when do you feel suicidal sometimes? What made you feel suicidal?
You know, when I have people reach out to me to do the things I used to do for the label before as a service, and, you know, they are offering so much. I'm just totally unmotivated. The money doesn't move me. The positioning, the plugins, nothing moves me. I'm just like, you know what? If it happens, it happens. You know.
Right, so you now, feel unmotivated about life?
Yes, and suicidal about, like, everything. There's no point of anything anymore. That's what I felt like. And that's what I feel like sometimes when I remember the situation.
So the question I want to ask you is this. What did you learn from this experience?
I think I had to lean towards being positive, basically, because...
What did you learn? Not what you had to do. Nothing.
Nothing.
Okay, good. Nothing. The second question I want to ask you is that what do you do right now?
I do events, and I also lead strategy for a company.
Are you able to pay your bills?
Yes, very well, very clearly.
Oh, very clearly?
Yeah.
So you're able to take care of yourself?
Very well.
Is that something to be grateful? Why? How do you get the money to do that?
From working and...
From working? Yes. So you're able to, you're still able to work, but you're useless. Just by your face, you're below 32, right?
Yes, I'm you're below 30.
What?
I'm below 30.
Do you know people your age cannot feed? Don't talk to me. Do you have people like that?
Yes.
Do you live by yourself or you live with your parents?
I live by myself. I'm actually 25.
How many people at your age live with their parents that can't take care of themselves?
There are lots. There are lots.
The reason why you feel that way is this. So first of all, it's because I can see you're driven and you have high expectation of yourself. But when something goes wrong, you have to slow down and say, what is this teaching me? I can tell what to learn from that. You know, I can tell what to learn from a situation. But what you need to remember is that I'm way off better than a lot of people. You need to remember that you're way better than a lot of people. Do you know people lose their jobs? Even bank managers that cannot survive for 3 months. That all of a sudden it will show on their children, it will show on their family that they can't survive. But that is not your own story. You're able to transit. And let me tell you what you should be grateful for. Thank you. Thank God you are learning this at 25, not at 42. You know some things you should think, Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord. You know, maybe you have a breakup in a relationship. Father, I thank you I broke up my relationship. The reason why is that I broke up my relationship. I didn't break up my marriage. Are you listening to me? Some of you that kind that you broke up a relationship, you should kneel down and say, Father, thank you. That it was relationship that broke, not my marriage that broke. Because some people have entered marriage before that thing happened to them. So you should be grateful that this happened to me at this phase of my life when it was not, when the failure or the problem did not have huge damaging effects. Because for some people, it will ruin them if it happened to them later on in life. And you should be grateful that I have the opportunity I can grow through this right now. You know why? At 25, there's nothing you cannot correct in your life. If you want to go to school again, by 29 you are out. Another life has started. Praise God. Let's get back to the teaching. Let's get back to the teaching. Praise God. Have you been helped today? So let me say something quickly. I'm doing. One of the things you will learn, one of the things which I'm going to teach next week is about discouragement, is that you can really fix discouragement by changing the way you think. But we'll talk about attention next week. But the first way I want to deal with discouragement that is by changing what you say. When people are discouraged, what are the words that they use? Hands up, tell me. When you are discouraged, what are the words that you use? Give it to that guy that wore black, the guy that spoke. What are the words that you use when you were discouraged? When you were in that deep hole, what were the words that you used? Tell me. Focus on him very well. Stand up, stand up, sir. Stand up, stand up. When you're discouraged, what are the words you use?
I'm done with this. I'm not enough.
No, hold on. I want to see the video. I can't see very well, so I'm waiting for them to share the video.
Yeah. So when I'm discouraged,
yeah.
I use words like, I'm not enough. I'm done with this. You know, life can take its course. My mom is my greatest motivation, so I'm just like, my other siblings will take over. And, you know, I just is very...
Relax. Remember my question to you. Don't tell me a story. Give me 5 or 6 sentences you use when you are in that state.
Okay. Tosin, you're not enough. Tosin, you're not smart enough for this thing. You have to go and learn again for it. You know, I just disqualify myself generally.
Yeah, Tosin, you're disqualified. That's the third one. The fourth one.
The fourth one is... When people reach out, I
don't... Tosin, you're messed up. Yes. You know, just... Yes.
Yeah. Everything is just Tosin, you're wrong.
Tosin, you're wrong.
Yes.
Yeah. And how does that make you feel?
It makes me feel really bad, honestly. And, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I wanted to watch something. See, notice the words that are used when people are discouraged. Who else want to share their story with me? Yeah, go. There's a lady just... On this side also, yeah. Lady, yeah.
Good day, everyone. So yeah. I'm not generally just sharing a story. I'm just, based on what she said and what he said, they're just little things that we just need to correct as Christians. The devil has no new tricks. Because tell me how it's possible that in the beginning of the word, God said he would make man in his image. But at the end of the day, the devil was able to convince Eve into thinking that God does not want her to be like him. And that's the only reason why she ate that apple, so she could be like God. There was a time in my life where I was feeling like I'm a good person, but it just turns out that everyone around me was just doing one bad thing to me or the other. So my thought process at that time was, there's definitely something wrong with me.
Okay.
But we have people who are damaged, doing damaged things to other people. Hurt people. You're not the only one going through it. Just have the mindset of you can, you will.
All right. Thank you. Praise God. Back to my question, very powerful contribution, but I'm trying to run a thought, so I don't want it to be broken. Back to my question, what do you say to yourself when you're depressed, when you're discouraged? What do you say to yourself? Anybody, person here? Yeah, there's someone over there at the back. Forward, up in front of the lady that just spoke just now. Yeah, what do you say to yourself when you feel there? Yeah.
Good day, church.
Good day.
So what I say to myself is there's no point, like nothing can work. Yeah. That's the end of life.
Nothing can work. Yeah. Can you take off your glasses so I can see your face? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, tell me. There's no point.
Yeah, there's no point doing this.
Nothing can work.
Yeah, sometimes I just feel...
Don't tell me what you feel. Just tell me what you say. I want to focus on what you say. What do you say? What do you say to yourself? What do you say to others when you're discouraged? What do you say? Yeah.
I'm tired. I can't do this anymore. It's too stressful. Yeah.
Did you notice the confusing look on her face? Do you notice when he spoke, he was smiling before, then he lost his joy? The reason why is that what you say affects your being. So tell me three more things you say. And I wanted to notice her. Yeah.
I don't know.
That's one of the things you say. When I don't know. What's going on? I don't know.
Most times, I don't even know how to put it in words. I don't know what's going on. I don't know. I'm just feeling this way. I'm just tired. Maybe if I rest, if I relax, I'll be okay. I'll come back. That's all.
You know, I'm only saying to you that this is what I want to say. Not the words you use when you are discouraged and depressed. Start using the opposite. Someone else wants to say something there. You are trying to give the microphone to someone. Yeah. 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 Start saying the opposite. That's what I'm going to. What do you use when you're discouraged? Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Okay. The first one is, I'm drowning.
Uh-huh.
And God, can't you see? Can't you see what your child is going through? I'm tired. Well, you win some, you lose some. I'm done. Is that some of the things I say when I'm discouraged?
And do you notice that even the tone of her voice went down? Because your voice can determine your willpower, your energy, all those things. And I wanted to notice the power in this woman's story. This woman was taking her child, the child was dead. But at every time she was saying, it is well, it is well, it is well. It was not just a mere confession, she was saying something that was affecting her. Give it back to that lady. Give it back, no, she let her have the microphone, yeah. When you are very pumped, what do you say? No, hold on, don't talk now. I want to see your video first. What do you say?
I'm happy, and I didn't even talk much, I just dance. Start to dance and sing and laugh. And I say, I'm happy, thank God, thank you, Jesus. And I keep dancing.
Did you notice how a smile came out? The reason why is that something just changed. She just changed what she said. Her smile did not just come out. The tone of her voice went higher. So I want us to learn from this woman. This woman, a child was dead. And he kept saying, it is well. Because you think it's a Christian cliche. It's not. Your words are either drowning you or they are floating you. Oh. Your words are either drowning you or they are floating you. The question is that, what will you use your word for? Will you use them to drown you or you will use them to float you? You know the thing, you know the reason why your words are powerful? Because you begin to say the wrong things and you begin to ask yourself the wrong question. Like that lady asked herself, what did you say? He said, God, can you see? What did you ask yourself again? Where's that lady?
Yeah, I said, God, can't you see what your child is going
through? Did you see? So, because it's an impression that tells you that you're neglected by God. So you say, God, can't you what? See. Be careful of asking the wrong question because you'll find the wrong answer. What a wrong question. Why is my life like this? Wrong question. Am I the only one? Wrong question. God, what? God, why? Why me? Wrong question. The reason why is that the question you ask yourself will direct your attention to something else. If I say, so when you ask that God that question, where's that lady? When you ask, tell me that question again.
God, can't you see what your child is going through?
What do you think our mood will be? Our mood, the answer to that question will always be negative mood. What about if you said, God, I know you will not fail me. The answer to that question will be always positive. God, I know I can trust you. The answer to that will always be positive. So the question is this, what are you saying to yourself? So when you say, God, can't you see me? And you say, God, I know you can't see me. Do you know the answer? When you say, God, can't you see me? Means that, God, I know you're not paying attention. When you say, God, I know you can see me, that's very different. One is going to bring you fear. One will bring you assurance. Use your words to float your life, not drown your life. So every time you're discouraged, can we do a deal? Can you pay attention to what you say? You say something, nothing is working. Because when you say that, you begin to drown yourself. Everything is working against you. You begin to drown yourself. You see the first lady, I don't know why. Maybe I've offended God. Maybe God doesn't answer my prayer. But all of a sudden, a brother got a job. She found a sister that sponsored her. She found a love of life. Oh, but God answers my prayer. As soon as she got to see that, the joy lit up in her mouth. Praise God. I said, praise God. Hallelujah. Were you blessed today? Okay, let's take one more. One more. Someone that is very discouraged and what's going on in your life and you need some help with it. Someone that is very, very discouraged. I don't know, it's like mildly discouraged. You know, some of you just like, oh, I'm not eating that. No, like really discouraged. Like, yeah. I have three. Who should I take? Who? Her, right? Okay, let's give it to her. They gave it to her, yeah. And we'll close with this. Someone say hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, tell me. Good afternoon. You need to hold the microphone louder so your mouth so that I can hear you.
When we're so close to like our breakthrough and we can literally almost touch it, it feels like things just get taken away from us at like the last stage. Yes.
So what do you think? So how do you feel about this?
Very discouraged. Like, what's the point?
What's the point of trying?
Yes.
So why would you try again? Yeah, so have you noticed life? Let me talk about life. Eh? Life is such that when you try, if you want to get to a point, you may not get there, but you move one step closer. But if you try again, you move what? One step closer. Let me tell you why we don't pay attention. Ever look at this. Look at these two speakers. Please focus on the speakers. This is where I started from. This is where I'm going to. Or maybe, yeah, this is where I started from. This is where I'm going to. Look at where I am. I'm here and I'm so discouraged because I've not gotten to where I'm going to. But guess what I've not looked at? I've not looked at my left and see where I'm coming from. Most of the time, we always look at where I've not gotten to. You don't pause and see how far you have come. You don't pause and see how this thing has changed you. How this has grown you. Question, has this grown you as a person? What all you've been through, has it grown you as a person? Not really. So are there things, so I will ask you a practical question. Are there things you never learned how to do or things you never knew in business that you have had to learn in the last few months?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
You've grown. Are there mistakes you've made before you know you'll never make again? Yes or no?
Yes.
Why do you mean you've not grown? You know why you say you've not grown? Because you are so vision focused, you cannot even look backwards and be like, wow, you know what? I've grown. As a matter of fact, one of the things you can do is to write a little summary and say, if you want to do this kind of business, 10 ways to get it wrong, I will teach you. And the reason why is that all of your lessons of the how you blew it, how you made a mistake. But the problem is that because you are so focused on what you want to get to, you're not taking a moment and saying that, wow, I've come all the, this is where I started from. Look at all the way. Look at where I am. Look at where I am. And this is just one step, I will get to it, but I've come a long way. So sometimes in our bid to hit our goals, we don't slow down and look at how far we have come. Let me tell you what I think you should do. When you get home today, get a book. All the things I've learned on my journey. And sometimes you'll be surprised that you've learned a lot of things that you're not even using again. And the way life is, if you don't learn the lesson, it will come back again to haunt you. So the first thing I will say is this. Can you go back and be like, this is all I've learned. And ask yourself, with all I've learned, what can I do with it? Praise the Lord. There's this, how many of you know the post-it? Post-it. You know post-it they use? You know post-it? That paper, the gum that they put on things. It's called post-it, right? Yeah. Do you know what? Stick on. I think post-it is a brand. Stick on is the right name. You know, do you know how the person that made stick on made it? The stick on guy, if I remember very well, was a scientist. He was trying to produce an equipment, but the equipment never saw the light of the day because it failed. But in producing it, he was using a lot of papers to produce equipment. So he kept on putting them along the wall. You know what? Along the way, he now said, let me just create this thing that can make things this way. You know, along the line. Along the line, what he wanted to create failed, but he invented the stick-on. So much so today, whatever he has created or wanted to create is not as popular or as famous as the stick-on. Sometimes we are so bent on this, we cannot see how far we have come. Is the guy an inventor today? He is. His invention by mistake is even more popular than what he thought he was going to invent. Praise the Lord. So what's my counsel to you? Go back. You are the one that think nothing has happened. Look back. What have you learned? This thing has grown our prayer life. It has grown. What have you learned? How can what we have learned turn to something else for us? And you need to start using the right words. Use your words to float you, not what? Drown you. So what will you start saying? Things are... Give her the microphone again. I want to speak to her husband. What words do you guys say in your family all the time when you talk about this? Tell me the words. Yeah.
Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon. Tell me the words you use. Yeah. Tell me the sentences you use. Not a story. Tell me what do you say? Yeah. Things are tough. Things are not.
What's the point of all this?
What's the point? Things are not working. Yeah. And when you say those words, you get encouraged, right? No, because your what is sinking you. Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, your what is what? Sinking you. So start using words that will encourage you. Because the reason why is that if you get discouraged, then you can't do nothing again. You need to push. And your push is going to come from your words. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Can we pray? Let's stand on our feet and pray. And I'm going to ask the choir to lead us in a great session of praise and worship. So I hope that we can do that. Let's stand on our feet and pray. Let's stand on our feet. Say with me, say things are working out. Say things are getting better. My prayers have been answered. Say I'm loved. I'm more loved than Satan hates me. I've got more going for me than against me. It is well with my soul. All I know, I will have a testimony. And that is my story. Say grace. Say grace. Say grace. Say this is my story. You need to stand up and say that. You need to stand up in faith and say that. The reason why is that the posture of sitting down is a posture of depression. I'm telling you, depression has posture. Depression has posture. If you can, if I say be depressed right now, you know what's going to happen? The first time we open is here. It will bend like this. Then your head will follow. And success has posture. When pastor, you see them like people are just chest out. And I'm saying so because I understand you feel that way. But the only way you can help yourself is to change what you say and how you behave. And the thing is that if you feel more encouraged, you will take more decisions that will encourage you. You will take decisions that will spark up your life. I understand. I really, and the reason why I've been there before, I've been there in a situation where I feel very discouraged. And I don't want to say these things, but I've taught myself. Can I be honest with you? Up to this morning, when I get up, I sit down on my chair. The chair's in my sitting room. I sit down and I talk for 15 minutes. 15 minutes, I talk. I'm talking to myself. But you notice, but it's my sister. He noticed it when, because we had an early morning meeting. So I couldn't do it in the house. He noticed it. As soon as I got to the car, one early morning, 6 a.m. No, about, we left 5, 6, something like that. We couldn't do it. As soon as I got into the car, they were in front. They just noticed. I was just talking. I noticed they were seeing from the mirror. I didn't care. I was just talking. The reason why is that if I don't talk strength into myself, who will? And let me tell you something there. You are the one that would, is your energy from within that used to fight the battle of life. Oh. If you let your energy die, you are finished. Hey. Things are tossing at all. Things will get tougher. Oh. You always remember that things can always get tougher. I know that things are tough, but always remember that things can get tougher. And the way they will get tougher is for you to fold your hands and do nothing. So with the energy I have, boom, I've shut up the whole place. So me, I'm your pastor that you think I'm always... And the reason why that my job is very dangerous. I do a dangerous job. All of you come and load me your problem. I must have a way to offload. After this meeting, oh, that's the outside. Pastor, I want to see you. They just load me with problem. I say, pastor, go home. But what I've learned is this. I go back and I don't think I'm going to see. I will begin to look for what I'm grateful for. So I'm grateful for a lot of things. Praise God. I'm grateful for a lot. In my phone, I have a gratitude journal. What I write every day that things I'm grateful for. The reason why is that it's a choice to be grateful. Praise God. This is what I wanted to do. I'm going to say one. And when I say one, you'll lift up your hands and think of one thing you're grateful for. And say, Father, I'm thankful. Let me tell you what I'm grateful for this morning. I traveled a while back, and as I was coming, I missed my flight. And when I missed my flight, I picked up the phone and called the flight agent. I said, I've missed my flight. He said, what should we do? I said, I need the next available flight out of here. He told me the amount. I said, please buy the ticket. And he bought the ticket. I didn't even send him money. When I got back, I said, Father, I'm grateful for choices. What's choices? Some people, if they miss their flight like that, it's finished. They will be begging up, down, rolling on the chair, this and this, and because they don't have financial choices. You know what I'm talking about? I'm grateful that what I eat, I want to eat, not I'm compelled to eat it. That's choices. I'm telling you, some of you here, the only way you come to church by Uber, you have no choice. But some of you can decide, should I take the Toyota? Or I should take the Lexus? Choices. Some of you, you even have people that will carry you in their car. You don't buy fuel, but you enjoy AC. I'm only telling you because these are things to be grateful for. Do you know in some countries you can't gather and worship Christ like this? Yeah. Lift up your hands and thank Him for something. One, thank you for one thing. Two, thank you for something else. 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 Think through your life. What are you grateful for? What has happened this week that you are grateful for? What relationship in your life? What breakthroughs in your life are you grateful for? What are some great things that have happened so far that you are grateful for? Three. What else? Number three. What is the third thing you're grateful for? What is the third thing you're grateful for? Amen. And Father, well, thank you for your word. I'm praying that you give all of us the discipline to be able to use our words to lift our life and not drown our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen. Were you blessed today?